Good morning, everyone. We're here to speak about cybersecurity and tokenization this morning. And so to begin, just give you a quick agenda of our morning. We'll be talking about some fundamentals just to make sure we're on the same level set when we begin, and then talk about four controversial implementation issues, as you can read them right there, and we'll be going through each one, and then make some conclusions. We would request that you actually save your questions till the end, because the way we're going to run this session is I'm going to be asking Jeff a lot of questions as we go through, so I may actually ask the question that you have. But just make a note of it in case we don't get to it up here. So to begin with, what is tokenization? You might ask that. Well, we have some definitions here, definitions by different people. The first one is from PCI. As you all know, PCI is the payment card industry. And because PCI deals with cards, then what the key piece of information on the card is what? The account number. So this definition from PCI has kind of a narrow scope because it's only talking about the PAN. So the tokenization is a process by which the PAN, primary account number, is replaced with a surrogate value called a token. And an index token is defined as a cryptographic token that replaces the PAN based on a given index for an unpredictable value. So they've actually got two kinds of definitions, Jeff, there?
Sub-definition.
Sub-definition. All right, we'll go with that. ANSI, the American Standards Institute, X9 committee, has another definition, which is in a standard that we are currently developing and is in ballot. And so that particular definition is a bit more broad. It's the process of mapping a plain text value, in other words, the underlying sensitive value, and so we call it a USV, underlying sensitive value, to an existing or newly generated surrogate value, aka the token. So the token is that surrogate value used in place of the original value in certain well-defined situations. But that is not used in place of the original value in every way that the original value can be used. So sometimes you use a token, sometimes you don't use a token. And thirdly, we have EMV. EMV stands for the Europay MasterCard Visa. That was their original definition, the three companies that came together to form a consortium and that was originally creating a standard for, what do they sell? Payment cards. The standard is now managed by EMV Co., a derivative consortium that actually is equally, the control of it is actually equally split between Visa, MasterCard, JCB. What is JCB? Yeah. American Express is in there. There's a Chinese Union Pay and Discover Card. So EMV also is a little confusing because it's the name of the technical standard that they wrote for the smart card payment cards, for the payment terminals, and also for ATMs that can accept them. So we don't have one definition because each of the three entities have their own implementation definition. That, to me, is confusing, because usually if we have a definition like cryptography, we kind of know what it is. Here it's like, which definition are we using?
That's part of the problem.
That is part of the problem. Okay, so again, let's just see, okay, how can we use this? Why do we even do this? So in our slide here, you'll notice that we have a PAN, primary account number. We also have other data, like the social security number. We also have a person's name, right there. These can all be USVs, underlying sensitive values, that you want to protect. And in tokenizing them, using a number of different methods, I'm not gonna kill you with this laser, I promise. We'll be talking about these different methods, but you use one of them to tokenize them, and you can end up with something numeric, something alphanumeric, and can be even some combination of the two. So the USV is, in cryptography, kind of like the clear text, the plain text, and the format, again, is kind of different. The mapping is typically format preserving, but does not have to be format preserving. Okay, Jeff, why don't you talk about this with a little more detail then about how these things get transferred into tokens to expand.
I get to do this one, huh?
Okay. Yeah, you go for this one.
So we're gonna use the PAN as the example. So my PAN in this case is gonna be a 16-digit card number. It begins with a 4, we all know that's Visa. And then the first 6 digits is what we call in the industry the BIN or the bank identifier number. And we route those. We take those BIN numbers so we know that when a credit card comes in from a merchant, I know which issuing bank it goes to so that they can do the authorization. The last 4 digits are kind of special. We will put those on receipts and we often use those as a reference. So for example, when you call in a customer service, they'll go, well, what's the last 4 digits of your card? And you give it to them and they have a pretty good sense that that's the correct card. And the last digit is a check digit. It's an actual formula to verify the integrity of all the other digits. So typically, it's the middle 6 digits in the current world of 16-digit cards, although we have 13, 15, and others. It's the middle 6 that we're really worried about. So the first example, token 1, is whoever they are, the implementer, has decided they're going to tokenize the middle 6 digits. And often, they will do this for backwards compatibility. So they can take the real middle 6, substitute it for a token, and still process. So they're legacy applications. It's all numeric, looks like a card, smells like a card, but it's not the original card. So this gives them backward capabilities. Alternatively, they might do token 2, where they decide to actually go ahead and tokenize the entire card. Now on token 1, you notice they actually changed the check digit because they didn't tokenize that. They actually calculated the real check digit because some applications would throw it out if the check doesn't verify. So in token 2, they decided to tokenize the whole thing, and typically when you do that, your applications, you actually have to have a separate communication channel. So over here, I get tokens, I process tokens. Over here, I get real cards, I process cards. And if I ever mix the two, I could have some lots and lots of problems. So those are the 3 examples, and as Sandy had mentioned earlier, the issues with this is when I'm gonna tokenize something is, what's the format? Am I gonna go numeric to numeric, or numeric to alphanumeric, or whatever? What's the length? Is the token the same size? Is it bigger? Is it less? These are things you have to deal with. And then the overall syntax, like the check digit. Do I have to do some preserving information on it?
So what's the rule, Jeff? Is there a rule as to when you know if you're going to tokenize the first half, the last half, the middle half?
Are there rules? Yes.
Okay, what's the rule?
There is no rule. There's no single rule.
Wait a
rule.
Second.
There's
you
rules.
Just said there was a rule.
There's rules, plural.
Rules, plural.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
And
that's
it depends on
clear.
Who you're dealing with, what industry you're in, and who your customers are.
Okay. All right. So that's tokenization, Jeff. What is detokenization?
So detokenization is basically the inverse. And the only way I can really explain this is if we go over this per method. Did we jump? Yes, we jumped one too many. Oh, you hit the key too, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Okay. So I'm going to do the encryption one first because this is a cryptography session and, you know, this is sort of straightforward. So I take the USV, I put it in the tokenization system, and the encryption method says I have a cryptographic key. I actually just encrypt it. The token is really my ciphertext. And I can detokenize. I can take that token and I can decrypt it using that same cryptographic key. Now, in this method, I don't have to store anything because I can recover the USV from the original token. So that is a method. MAC, message authentication codes, they're a little different. I still have a cryptographic key, I still apply it to the USV, I still create the token, but I don't have enough information from the token to recover the USV. So in this case, if I'm gonna support detokenization, and this is why the line is dotted, I'm actually gonna have to keep a database and map every USV to every token, so if I have to detokenize, I can actually look it up. A lot of systems that use MAC, I'm told, actually do verification, and they don't support detokenization. But the point I made was, well, gee, if I'm pulling in a vendor product and they use this method, and I input the USV and I get the token out, I can keep my own database, so I can do my own detokenization. And the answer was, yeah, you're right, okay. So the next one is random. Random is a little simpler. I have some source of a random number generator. I get in the USV. I replace the USV with a random value. And now because they don't have any correlation whatsoever, one's not derived from the other, I have to keep that database. I have to maintain that if I'm going to do that detokenization service. And then finally, we have the table method. This is actually a very popular method. And the table method says I have a random number generator source. I take that as my seed, if you will. I put that into a pseudo-random number sequence. And from that, I generate these tables. And now I can use the table to input the USV. Out pops the token, and it's actually reversible. I can take the token, put it in the table basically in reverse order, and recreate the USV. So I can use the table to do that, and I don't necessarily have to have that database.
Now, in some of the literature I've read, there is another name for this, not just table method. Sometimes it's called a static table method.
STM.
STM, yeah. And then other times it's called a static table driven method.
No, I don't like that acronym.
STD.
Yeah.
No? Okay. So what does static mean if somebody's reading and they're reading static table?
So I generate the table one time, and I create all my tokens using that table. And I have to keep that table so that I can detokenize if necessary. Because if I change a table, I'm going to get a different answer that could break the system. So once I generate the table, I have to keep it and maintain it.
So if that table gets
static,
okay. If that table gets somehow destroyed or whatever, then do you have to
destroyed, lost, damaged, stolen? Yes, you could have some problems.
You're in big trouble then.
All right.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So moving along, let's look at some of the implementation issues with payment versus non-payment tokens. This is a really complicated slide, Jeff. So I'm going to let you do this one.
Okay, and the reason it's complicated is,
do.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know which one I'm doing until she decides. The fact that it is complicated is sort of the point. So this is a combination of legacy systems, a combination of online payments, and a combination of tokenization. So we're going to start on the right-hand side with the issuer, and the issuer is a financial institution. They're going to generate a card, a plastic card, and they're going to issue it to the user, who we call the card holder.
That's the left side, but
on the left side, correct.
Who's counting?
Eh, whatever. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I do.
Somebody's left, somebody's
right. They understand
it,
too.
Okay. What's in the payment industry, we're not very inventive with our terms. So the issuer issues the card, and the card holder holds the card. We repeat ourselves a lot. So anyway, in step one, the card holder gets the card. Now, the card may actually have an EMV chip on it. It might be a smart card. But that has nothing to do with EMV tokenization, and that's a point of confusion. The person, once they have the card, could go to an old-fashioned brick-and-mortar merchant and get goods and services and pay for it with the card. But to do the EMV tokenization, they have to download a wallet, and you're talking Apple Pay, Google Pay, Samsung Pay, one of these guys. And what you do is when you install that wallet, it's going to say, give me the card number. So the user is going to enter that PAN. The wallet then is going to go upstream and send the PAN to a token service provider. Now, which provider, what provider, where is that provider? It depends. Is it an Amex card, a Discover card, a Visa card, or a MasterCard? So all that has to be decided. What it does is it turns back what we're going to call EMV, which is really the EMV token, and that's what gets stored in the wallet. So the PAN is not stored on the phone, just the token. Now, in step two, once that EMV token is set up and ready to go, we can then jump to step three, where the cardholder can then shop online, and the EMV token is sent to the merchant online upstream. Now, the merchant, like legacy systems, has to go to its acquirer, and the acquirer is yet another financial institution that the merchant operates with, and the acquirer acquires the authorization. I told you we're not very inventive with our terms. Now, in this case, in some cases, the acquirer, I'm told, could actually go back to the TSP, the token service provider, and detokenize. Say, here's an EMV token. I need to know what the real PAN is. Get the PAN back, and then give that to the issuer so they can actually do the authorization. In other cases, the EMV token is sent to the issuer. If that's the case, the issuer has to have that database. They have to be able to look up the EMV. that's amazing. As I talk, that dot moves around. That's awesome.
Thank you.
They look up the PAN. The PAN is the account number. The account number can be used to look up the customer profile, and now the issuer can do what they do. The point here is that EMV is used for the authorization process. It's not used for anything after the authorization. So we have the auth or pre-auth process, as some people like to call it, and we have the post-auth. So post-auth tokens are not used for payments. So we have the term non-payment tokens.
This is confusing.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
What's your point?
That it's confusing. Okay. Let's move on to something less confusing.
Okay, so let me do a non-payment. Okay. And so we have slightly different terminology. So in the middle, I have my tokenization system. And we like to think of it composed of three components. There's the interface, the TRI. There is the tokenization service itself, and that's one of those four methods, the encryption, the MAC, the random, or the static table. And I might have storage, depending upon which method I'm using or depending on my implementation. Again, the tokens we're talking about here are not EMV tokens, okay? They're something else. And what I have that feeds into the system are what we call requesting entities. Now, these are not individuals, typically. These are applications requesting either, I need a token, here's a USV, you give me the token back, or they could ask for detokenization. I have a token, I need to get the USV back. So there are different types of requesting entities.
How's anybody going to know whether they're asking for tokenization or detokenization? Or?
That's part of the system and part of the implementation and part of the controls that you have to put in place.
Okay. All right. So this is our second issue, then.
I'll let you do this slide, okay.
Yeah, okay.
So let's say I'm gonna do an implementation. So I have my tokenization system sitting in the middle with my three components, and I have all these requesting entities, these are my applications. Now, depending upon who your organization is, I might be tokenizing PANs, I might be tokenizing Social Security numbers, I might be tokenizing anything I want. And some of these requesting entities are going to be asking for the tokens. Others are going to be detokenized. So I think we have a color differentiation there to try to, yeah, show that?
Yeah, it's supposed to be kind of like a lighter purple.
Yeah, I'm hoping that shows up. But not every application in my enterprise is going to need or tokenization or detokenization. So we have NTs, non-tokenization users. And the question becomes, how do I separate my NTs from my requesting entities who are authorized to use the tokenization system? Now this is assuming I have a tokenization system and all my applications are using that same system.
And can one RE both request both functions, tokenization and detokenization, or is it one or the other?
Theoretically, it could be either.
Right.
It depends on your implementation, on your application needs, and what you're doing in your business.
I think I've heard you say that before on some of the other sites.
You're going to hear it again.
Depends on your implementation.
Absolutely.
Oh, where have we heard that before? Okay.
Now this is where it's an internal system, okay?
Right.
What happens, and I hit the button.
Yeah.
What happens if I have REs, because I'm a business, I'm operating in a global environment, what happens if my REs are external to my organization? Well, that means I have to have some kind of an API that I have to push out to my DMZ, and they have to be authorized to come in, so I better authenticate them, I better authorize them. And I'm going to let them talk to my tokenization system because they're part of my business partners. So internally, I have my own REs. Internally, I have my NTs. And externally, I have my REs. And guess what? I just became a third-party service provider.
Is that whether, like, are we talking like cloud?
Could be. Whether I realized it or not, I just did that.
Well, in this case, when you have a third-party provider, then it behooves all of us to make sure that we have really strong audit programs over those third-party providers, right? And make sure that responsibilities are nailed down in your contracts. It's very complex, but wait, it can actually get worse. Next slide.
So all of the talk we've had up to this point says I have a tokenization service. What happens if I have more than one in my entity, in my enterprise? I may have a product from more than one vendor. They may use different methods. They may use the same method. So now I have these issues. If I have two tokenization systems, do some of my REs talk to system A and some use talk to system B? Or can they talk to both systems? How do I make that decision? How do I control that? And the issues, if I have more than one tokenization system, is interoperability. Do they need to interoperate? If they're using different methods, there's a good chance they're not going to be able to. And gee, what happens if I tokenize the token from another system? That's an interesting problem.
Yikes.
Maybe I have two systems because I have one. I've been using it for a while. For whatever reason, I decide I'm going to change vendors or change methods. So now I have to migrate from one system to another. How do I get the old tokens to the new token systems? And then when I have all these multi environments, what about system backup and recovery? So this could all be very, very, very problematic.
Yeah, this can all, this is sometimes not even your own fault. It might be you have a merger and acquisition situation where, you know, you were just fine, happy and, you know, everything, and then all of a sudden, you know, you get bought by somebody
sure.
else.
Got a technology technology transition you have to deal with.
Right, and product decommissionings and then, you know, cryptographic transitions. So it's very complex.
And don't forget about your backups.
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah, real bunch of issues going on here. Okay, let's go to our third issue, system isolation.
Yeah, okay. So up to this point, we've been talking about multiple systems. We've been talking about using an internal system. So here I have my tokenization system. And you know, my REs are out there somewhere. And I'm an enterprise. I'm connected to the internet. So I have a DMZ. I touch the internet. So the question is, how do I protect my tokenization system internally and externally? So maybe I have a router that I've controlled things around. I have router rules in place. Maybe I've done a hard switch so that only certain people can get in on that sub piece of the subnetwork. Maybe I'm relying totally on firewall rules, okay? So how do I keep my NTs from accessing my system internally, and how do I keep people externally from accessing my tokenization system? Now, if this sounds a little familiar, how many folks in here have done PCI or have to deal with PCI issues? Same isolation requirements. How do I manage my cardholder data environment? Different reason, same problem. And guess what? We don't have any good solid answers yet. We're still working on that stuff. Although PCI is doing a pretty good job.
Okay.
I have to say that, Ralph's in the front row.
Okay, so our fourth issue then is the the real killer issue.
You're gonna hit the button, okay.
Yes.
So this has been coined as the HSM or not HSM. That is the question. So let me explain what we mean, and I have to do this by each of the methods. So if I'm using the encryption method, is the key that I'm using to create and to encrypt and decrypt, to create the tokens and detokenize, is that key stored in a cryptographic security module? I have a cryptographic boundary. The key can never go outside that boundary. Or did I do everything in software, and it's sitting in memory, sitting on a hard disk? How do I protect that key? So HSMs, when you look at products that are out there today, because the tokenization industry is still pretty new, they're typically optional. And sometimes the way they interface the HSMs aren't the best methods that we've seen. So at the end of the day, all you can do, check with your vendor and see what they support and try to decide what you want to do and what you need to do. Because this is part of the isolation problem. How do I protect the sensitive data, not the USVs that I'm trying to protect with tokenization, but how do I protect the sensitive data inside the tokenization system itself?
Mm-hmm. This was probably the most contentious issue, even within the ANSI community where we're developing our standard. For decades, the card security folks have mandated that cryptographic keys be secured in hardware. So in your ATMs, keys in hardware. In your point of sale terminals, keys are in hardware. So when some vendors came along and developed an app where the keys would be maintained in the software, it was like, holy moly, you know, all the hands went up and people are screaming at each other. When we did the first ballot on our on our draft standard, we had about 170 comments, many of them no's with comments. And in the ANSI world, to develop a standard, you have to address every single one of those comments, 170 of them. Okay, so
It took a little while.
What?
It took a little while.
Oh, yeah.
We were meeting every single week.
Yes. So we thought we had those resolved and shipped off the next draft for a second ballot, thinking, okay, we're cool. Second ballot, 270 comments. They read it. Point says they read it. Probably true. They read it. This was like unheard of. And it's like, we're going in the wrong direction here. Usually with a next draft, you're supposed to have less comments. And here, you know, they were going upward logarithmically. It's like, holy no. So we addressed issues again, individually, every single one of them. And in a few weeks, we're going to go out for our third ballot with hopes of no negative votes. So
and reducing the total number of comments.
Yeah. They don't call us dreamers for nothing.
Right. So the good news is we're following procedures, we're doing the ballots, we're resolving the comments. The bad news is we have to do another ballot. So.
Yeah. Okay, so let's move on and look at this with the next method.
Yeah, so this was the encryption method. We're both hitting buttons.
You're not allowed to hit it. I'm driving. There we go.
So the Mac method looks an awful lot like it. I have a cryptographic key. Where is that key going to be stored? Is it going to be in software? How do I manage it? Is it going to be in the cryptographic hardware module? And again, you know, HSMs are typically optional. Check with your vendor. It's about the best you have so far.
Yeah, the dotted lines always mean it's optional.
Right.
May or may not happen.
May or may not be there. Right, exactly.
Right.
You're going to hit the button? Okay.
Yes, I'll hit the button this time. Okay.
Forward, please.
Forward.
Okay. Now, the random method's a little different. I don't have a key I have to deal with, but I have to have that random number generator. And how good is random, right? And random is very, very difficult to achieve. And in fact, there's even some quantum mechanical random number generators out there available on the market. So the question becomes, is my random number generator totally software-based? Is DevU random going to be good enough? Not really. But am I going to use a cryptographic module, an HSM, to do that? Again, you're going to have to check with the vendor. There are some products available out there. I don't know if any of them will interface with any of the tokenization products that are out there, but this is a real key area, is how good is the random number? Because if it's not so good, my tokens are predictable. Or I can run attacks and do hash tables and things like that and try to figure out what the underlying values are. So this is a concern, plus protecting that database, of course.
Of course. Okay, and how about this table
method? So we mentioned earlier the table's static, okay?
Static.
So I still have the initial random number generator problem, because if I don't have a good random number generator, even though it gets feed into the pseudo-random number generator, the PRNG is deterministic. So given an input, I know what the output's going to be. So I want the RNG, the non-deterministic, to be as random as possible. I want some really good values. Because once the table's generated, it's around for a long, long time. So the other problem you have is, where do I keep the table? Where do I store the table? Well, right now, they're in the server memories, because these tables are huge. We don't have HSMs that have sufficient memory to store these tables yet. We don't have HSMs that have a sufficient CPU to process the tables. HSMs tend to be very focused, very purpose to, you know, here's a cryptographic key, I encrypt, decrypt, I create a digital signature, I verify a digital signature, whatever my method is. They're not designed to do this. So when I use the table method, I'm dealing with software. So the real issue is, how do I up that ante and make it as secure as possible? Normally, the tokenization systems, because it is all software, if you look at the ISO 19790, that's the ISO version of the FIPS 140-1 for cryptographic, -2 for cryptographic modules, the best you're going to get is a security level 1 or 2, because that's software. You can't get to a 3 or 4, because that's hardware-based.
No. Okay, so with all of that, what are some of our conclusions? When you go back to your office after the conference, what are you going to do to apply what you've learned today? So first of all, we're suggesting that you share your understanding of tokenization with the people in your organization, with your peers, with your management. Get discussion going. Because tokenization is kind of like the buzzword of today. But as you can see from all the information we've already given this morning, is that it is not a slam dunk. There are a lot of complicated issues. So then we suggest you determine your tokenization needs, if any. Do you have EMV payments? Do you need it for PCI compliance? Or is it just an additional control mechanism that you're looking to implement? Next, define your tokenization strategy. What the heck do you mean by tokenization strategy? That sounds kind of like big and fluffy, and I think it's more squishy.
I wrote that bullet. All right.
Yeah.
So if the need is none, your strategy is, I'm not going to do tokenization. That could be one answer. If your need is, I do need it, for whatever reason I need it, then am I just going to pick one of the methods and go to the phone book and pick out one of the vendors and say, okay, that's it? Or am I going to do an RFP, request for a proposal? Am I going to do an evaluation? If I am going to do an evaluation, what are my requirements? That's part of the whole strategy, is how do I choose what I'm going to use and where I'm going to use it? Because one of the issues you have is, I have a tokenization service here, I have my applications all over, but guess what? I'm a huge enterprise. I got databases all over the world. I have network segments all over the world. Who can touch the tokenization system? When I tokenize something, who can process the token versus have to have the original USV? So does everyone who needs the USV process first and then tokenize? Or once it's been tokenized, do they detokenize? All these things have to be figured out as part of your strategy before you make the decision to do this implementation.
Right, yeah.
It's a lot for one word called strategy, but
that is true. That is true. So if you decide that you do want to do tokenization, then to plan your implementation, you have to look at all these issues that Jeff just mentioned. Where are you going to tokenize? Where are you going to process, store, et cetera? There are so many details. It's like the devil is in the details. And you have to think about these before you start even moving toward implementation. And a lot of upfront work, and once you've decided it, then you probably also need to do all of those background things. Change your corporate policy, your corporate InfoSec policy. Change your disaster recovery plans. So there's all of these soft things on the outside besides just the hard nut of implementing some piece of hardware.
And don't forget, if you're dealing with external entities who need to use your tokenization system.
Right.
Or maybe you are the external entity. You're dealing with an external tokenization system.
Yes, exactly. So lots of things to consider. It's not just going to, you know, if you're doing an implementation plan, I would suggest you don't put like a three-month time frame on it. You'll never make it. Okay, so our conclusions then are that tokenization can protect your underlying sensitive data, but you have to kind of tread carefully. It's a complex control that requires a lot of pre-planning based on, you know, all that we've talked about already, some of the four main issues. Standards and specifications and guidelines do exist, and some are still in development. So it's not like an age-old issue that has been, you know, totally black and white.
This is relatively new.
Yeah, so lots of flux at this point. Tokens are not a panacea. They are not for everybody. So, you know, if, for instance, if you want a database query for all customers and you have tokenized names for privacy, you can't do an alpha search because you're not alpha anymore. If you want to find all the customers under 30 years old by looking at their birth dates or their social security numbers, you may not be able to do that search anymore because you're tokenized.
Yeah, let me actually add a point on that one. So I've seen implementations where, and I'll use your example of the names, they want to be able to do searches so the names are in alphabetical order, but now they want to tokenize. And I've actually seen implementations where they've forced the tokenization. It's a token, I've protected it. But the tokens they map to alphanumeric stay in the same order, the same alphanumeric order. It's doable, but guess what? You're losing a lot of your protection controls.
Right.
You really are. And
it's predictable then.
Yeah.
An attacker would look at it and go, there's something going on.
Because your security levels are really dropping down.
Yeah, yeah. So there's no mixing and matching in this whole scheme because oftentimes the vendor products don't mix and match.
You mentioned the policies and practices earlier.
I did.
Incident response plans.
Yes.
Something went wrong. Is my tokenization system compromised? I'm okay and I lost one, or yes?
Yeah, all the USVs, are they dead? A lot of things happening there. So another thing that you have to pay attention to. We do have some references for you here in the packet with your slides. There's some ANSI standards, some PCI standards, and the EMV standard. By the way, just in case you're wondering, the tokenization, that is not a misspelling. The Europeans do tokenization with an S, not a Z, so don't go, what, don't these
right.
people know
spell
how to use spell
check? Spell with an S,
check?
Not a Z.
Yeah, yeah. So you can take a look at any and all of those to help you, you know, kind of put your thoughts together and remind yourself of all the issues that we've talked about. So with that, I think we have about 10 minutes left, and we can take questions. I know there was a question. Okay, Hoyt? Yeah, you are. You're in the front. One of the dangers.
Did I spell it right? I really try on that.
A lot of times you insert tokenization in the legacy system, okay? And the legacy system would use the process of credit cards. Because you're trying to make those programs essentially out of scope for the audits and the launch, you insert tokenization in the system, and they receive a token from the credit card. These systems often do send that token. Often have expectations of what that value is. And this problem is actually more prevalent than and why I'd also like to debate offline with you, we have a really rigorous random number generation, but it doesn't build a perfect kind of complete amount of it. That, if that, that approach does not work when you have to essentially take a consumption that matches the syntax.
I'm going to repeat
it. We'll repeat that question.
I'm going to repeat it.
It's a long question, but we'll repeat it.
When he gets
I'm
done.
Taking notes.
I'll sum it down really loudly. So the question here then, if I have a requirement for my token to match the syntax of the credit card, what is your recommendation?
So the question was...
Tread carefully.
The question was that if you're implementing tokenization into a legacy system, oftentimes those legacy systems have syntax checks. And throwing
and,
a token.
And part of that was we were showing with the credit cards where, you know, they will recalculate the check digit.
Right.
And you keep it all numeric and some of those things.
Right. So Hoyt's question then is, what do you do if you are in that situation where you're trying to do that? Is it going to, like, blow up your application because of syntax checking or any other type of checking that's done? And the answer is?
Well, that's part of your strategy. You have to evaluate that, because if you tokenize something, you can break your systems very easily.
Right.
That's part of it right there. So you have to figure out what you need to do. Part of the second question is there are some tokenization systems that do format preserving encryption and other format preserving, and they'll deal with, and we had this on the one slide, you know, you deal with the length and the format and the syntax. So there are some things there. But again, it's not a panacea. So tread very carefully. Figure out where you... Because if I tokenize something here and I have up feeds going upstream, I'm going to have to look at every one of those systems to see if they can either process the token or if they're going to have to be able to detokenize only for processing of each individual transaction. And that's going to add you overhead, it's going to add latency, it's going to affect your network because you're increasing your overall traffic. Yes, those are all things that have to be looked at.
Right,
so the question was, go ahead. So the question or the additional comment was, I have to be able to process the data even abstractly at some level. So for example, if I am doing Social Security numbers and I'm tokenizing them, if I'm looking at the number to be meaningful, do I need still look at the token as being the same level of meaningfulness? And those are things that are gonna have to be looked at.
You have to do the same kind of research as you did a long time ago when you were trying to follow PII, for instance, personal information. Where is it transferred from one system to another? And you really have to do the same thing here to see if you're sending a token down the line to from one system to another, you know, what's going to happen when you get to that other place?
Right. Let's say I'm an enterprise and I have to do protect, you know, credit card numbers for payments, and I want to do tokenization, so I have a solution over here. But I also deal with healthcare, So am I going to use the same solution for my PII over here, or am I going to use a different tokenization system, a different method, a different vendor? And maybe I have account numbers here. Some of them might be credit cards, some of them might not be. Am I going to protect the account numbers internally exactly the same way? This can get really out of hand really, really quickly.
Yeah, it's a lot of that's why we hit on the pre-planning. There's a huge amount of pre-planning that has to go on here. Another question?
Yes.
Yes.
When we talk about these tokenization solutions, two of them jumps really out. One is a vault-based, one is a vault-less tokenization solution where we do not have a vault where we are saving tokens, so no database queries. Is that the new industry standard? Because it's going to be fast, robust, and you can do tokenization on the fly.
When you say it's the new industry standard,
I'm asking. Will vault-less tokenization, is that where industry is going towards?
Well, there's not a standard. That's the first thing. So EMV has their own, right? PCI has their own guidelines in that space. The X9 standard we're working on is very intended to be very generic. This is where the four methods come from. So I could argue that the EMV tokenization is a form of the random method, for example, because you know they generate basically a pseudo card number that I can process like a card number. So yes, you have to have the vault in that case. So it depends on what method you're using.
Thank you.
Yeah, I hate to answer this way, but it depends.
Other questions? Okay, seeing none, I want to thank you very much for your attention this morning. And if you have any questions, we do have to clear the room, so we will be outside there. And have a wonderful rest of the conference. Thank you.